So signal conditioning for self-generating sensors. So we all know basically what are self-generating sensors and what are the resistive-based sensors or non-self-generative type. They could be capacitive or inductive or any other parameter-based sensor measurements. Now in the self-generating type, we have studied, we have often taken the example of thermocouple or piezoelectric sensors. Here what happens, we don't give any supply to them for initiation of the sensing action. So because of this, the outputs which we get from the sensors are going to have low amplitudes. Even the frequencies are going to be low because the variations, whatever we are trying to measure, may have lower frequencies. So because of this, usually the self-generating sensors have less amplitude. We have taken example of a thermocouple where microvolts of EMF is generated from the thermocouple, or the frequencies, low frequencies, as low as even 1 hertz or 2 hertz are also possible. And if the output impedance of the sensor device is very, very high, how exactly the conditioning of that particular network has to be done? How exactly the conditioning of that particular signal, whether it is a current or a voltage, has to be done? So the voltages or currents which are produced are low amplitude and low frequency in nature. If the device, if the sensor has got very low output impedance, then it's very easy to tap the output or sense the output. Otherwise, we have to have this high input impedance amplifiers or the signal conditioning networks. So basically, this is the necessary thing why we require the conditioning networks. So range of output is smaller than the input range of the ADC is usually the next stage of the sensors. Then AC amplifiers, which are designed to operate in the midband region. So they may not be suitable for the low frequency operations. So to tap these low frequency signals, where we come across the capacitor coupling issues, we need to design the circuit to tap the low frequency signals. Otherwise, usually our frequency response of the amplifiers, AC amplifiers, is basically concentrated to be used in the midband region. So low frequency and high frequency, we have issues of shunting of the capacitor or coupling capacitor issues, or if the input impedances are not properly matched, then there is a possibility of the output getting lower, or loading effects also come into picture. So because of these issues, the regular amplifiers which are designed to operate in the midband region are not suitable for low frequency signals, which are invariably the sensors are sensing. And whenever the resolution requirement is very, very high, the sensors always, the accuracy or the resolution is always high, because we are sensing a parameter. On the basis of this parameter value, all the next circuitry, especially the critical condition networks, are designed. So because of this, these voltages or currents are very, very crucial for us. So we require high resolution solution. So to overcome all these, or to aid in the conditioning of the sensor signals, we have studied chopper or low drift amplifiers. Then auto zero amplifiers, composite amplifiers, and electrometers and transimpedance amplifiers, also the charge amplifiers. Thus, the instrumentation amplifiers. So instrumentation amplifiers are useful in the resistive or capacitive or inductive sensors also, plus in the self-generating amplifiers also, they are used in any one of the stages. So these are the few circuits based around op-amp we have studied. And also we have studied the noise consideration for all of them, including the components which we have used. So here, in the Otto Zero or chopper amplifiers, what was the basic concern was, like how to, because all these circuits are designed around op-amps, so the input offset conditions of the op-amp play a major role in conditioning networks. So these op-amp circuits, or rather the op-amps which we are using, first thing, their input and output impedances plus their offsets have to be properly managed. So the drift issues associated with the op-amps, the drift issues associated with the resistors and the capacitors which are used in charge amplifiers and transient impedance amplifiers, or the instrumentation amplifiers where the DC offsets are reduced, or the chopper amplifiers where the switches are used, what type of switches should be used to get the proper resolution output. So these are the things which have to be considered when you are designing these particular amplifiers. In the chopper, basically, what we did is we used, our main concern was to reduce the offsets to zero so that every reading, whatever we take, or every sensor measurement, whatever is made, when it is interfaced to a chopper circuit, the offset voltages should not have any impact on the sensor readings, or there should not be any confusion with the sensor reading and the offset reading. So offset, if it is reduced completely to zero, whatever reading or the whatever output you get out of the chopper circuit is exclusively the sensor reading, not because of the noises or not because of the drifts happening or not because of the offset issues associated with the op-amps. So for this, some resistive networks are designed. Considering if there is a mismatch in the biasing currents, if there is any mismatch in the offset currents, which leading to the offset voltage at the two terminals. So under such cases, a specific network, resistive networks are designed such that these resistive networks balance the voltage which is appearing at the inverting and non-inverting terminals, so that the difference here, the VD difference, which is giving us the difference gain of the amplifier, that is taken care of. If this offset voltage, that is VD, which is VP minus VN, that is the voltage available at the non-inverting terminal minus the voltage available at the inverting terminal when the voltage, when the input given is zero. And this essentially occurs due to the difference in the offset currents or the bias currents which are used in biasing the transistors which are there in the difference amplifier stages of the op-amp. So once you take care of these biasing currents, ideally they should be equal so that the difference is zero. But practically, for many reasons, it could happen due to drifting, which is temperature dependent, or it could happen due to improper biasing resistors. So whatever may be the reason, at the terminals, when the input voltage is available, this should be reduced to zero, such that the effective voltage available here should be zero. For that, these resistors are designed. R3 is designed in such a way that which balances the source resistance plus the input resistance which is used. As a result, the difference gain, whatever we get here, is very, very high, which leads to high common mode rejection ratio. So this takes care of further readings. If the common mode rejection ratio is maintained high, the common signals that is the common gain AC, is maintained low, the common mode rejection ratio becomes very, very high. This helps in whatever the signals which are coming in here at the inverting or non-inverting terminals, because of the high difference gain, proper amplification of the correct signal, sensed signal happens. This gives us high accurate and high resolution outputs. This can be very easily interfaced with the next stage, which is invariably the ADC stage. So here we considered the output zero error and input zero error, which happens due to the different offset voltages. We also saw the effects of the ambient temperature, the casing temperature, plus the capacitance or the thermal resistances happening between the two lead resistors, or any capacitive effect which is happening, which is leading to the temperature variations in the circuit or the operating temperature of the circuit. So these different temperature variations result into power dissipation. This power dissipation in turn leads to input and output zero errors. So all of them are dependent on the temperature. So the casing temperature of the device, the circuit temperature, the operating temperature, the ambient temperature, all of them are very, very important. So the package, when it is done, the circuit, proper cooling arrangement is usually made. So either through fans or through air conditioners, the proper operating temperature or the ambient temperature is maintained. Even heat sinks are provided such that at proper places, such that the ambient temperature does not increase to a higher level. So we studied later how the offset voltage and currents are drifting with time. So how to take care of this drift? By designing again the proper networks, we are taking care of the drifts. Also the power supply rejection ratio. How this power supply rejection ratio plays an important role in maintaining the power supply voltage. Next, the chopper amplifiers, where the DC offset voltage, even if it is not reduced to zero, in practical cases, how a particular amplifier, when it is used, using this chopper circuit, the voltage is seen to it that it does not enter the actual reading. So using these switches in chopper circuits and in auto zero amplifiers, and these auto zero amplifiers are readily available in the form of IC. Those days when the auto zero amplifiers were not available, these zero amplifiers self-calibrate the device and also reduce the offset to zero. When these were not available, these chopper circuits were very, very popular. They made use of the modulation technique also, where a signal is modulated and then automatically the DC level comes to zero. You can reduce it to zero, then that output after demodulation can be used. So the carrier concept, which is DC shifted, that is used in chopper amplifiers. But these are no longer used now, because you have these auto zero amplifiers whose input and output impedances are also properly matched. Plus, they have two op amp configuration, where one main amplifier, which helps in amplification of the signals, the other amplifier or the nulling amplifier, which helps in reducing the offsets to zero with the help of these capacitors, where they hold the charges equal to the offset voltage, and they see to it that these offset voltage proportional, the charges proportional to the offset voltage are every time subtracted from this, so that the output is not affected by the offset even if it is present. So this is done every time it is used, so that automatically the auto zero, that is the offset voltages for every reading, is reduced to zero. It is not that in our 741 we used to reduce the offset to zero for every reading. We never tested. One setup we used to do this, but here for every change in the input this is happening. So the offset voltage will not reach the output end at all. So these are useful in self-correction and self-calibration. And these ICs, once they are used in this, once you test them for their accuracy and resolution level, they can be very easily used for longer period. They are more reliable. Then you have the composite amplifiers, where we make use of two amplifiers, one for reducing the DC offset, the other one for amplification. So by making use of this, the DC offset and of these two op amps is seen to it that the input and output zero errors are taken care of. Because exclusively one op amp is used for reducing the DC offset. So every reading, whatever comes, the DC offset reduced one only reaches the amplifier end. So this amplifier end only amplifies the signals whose offset voltage is negligible, or it is taken care of by the other op amp. And here you can see, by designing with the resistors, the final output voltage is nearly equal to the input offset voltage, or the input voltage whatever is available between the first stage amplifier and the gain. So by doing or by designing the composite amplifiers, we are taking care of the offset voltage as well as the drift happening in the amplifier setup, along with proper impedance matching, and amplification also is happening. So the next one is instrumentation amplifier. And in instrumentation amplifiers, what we have is set of input amplifiers and an output amplifier. Here you have two difference amplifier stages, and because of the two difference amplifier stages, the output zero error is nullified. This we have studied even in signal conditioning for the resistive networks also, and mostly in all the resistive, capacitive and inductive sensing networks, instrumentation amplifiers are the immediate stages where they take care of the offset as well as the amplification. And the bandwidth being very, very high, plus the input and output impedances are properly matched, they are most reliable amplifier stages. So they are used immediately after the sensor stage in resistive, capacitive and other sensing networks. So later, the electrometer and transimpedance amplifiers. So these electrometer circuits are basically for impedance matching. They are used because the input impedance of these electrometers are of the order of tera ohms, and also the output impedance is as low as few ohms. So the input current, basically they avoid the loading effect. If an electrometer is used along with sensing and amplifying the sensed signal, they can be used for impedance matching without the loading effect. Now, what is this loading effect? If the output impedance of any device is very, very high, then what happens, because of high output impedance and if the sensor is of current sensing type, the current will not flow into this high output impedance. As a result, the sensor current is too low. So in such cases, if it is interfaced with another device whose input impedance is low, then the loading starts happening. Because of this, the sensor readings we may miss out. Similarly, in the reverse case, that is, if the input impedance is high, if the input impedance is low, then also the same effect happens. The device starts loading. Instead of taking receiving more current, device starts loading. So whenever high the voltage sensing is happening, the input impedance is very high, then more voltage gets dropped, and this dropped voltage is given to the input terminals of the op amp, and they amplify this voltage signal. This is the normal procedure. But if the input impedance is low, then whatever drop is there across the input impedance is less. And when less voltage is given to the input terminals of the op amp, naturally the amplification of lesser amplitude signal happens. So sufficient amplification may not happen, or sufficient sensing also at the input end may not happen. So to avoid these, electrometer circuits are designed where proper impedance matching is done. So especially when the current sensing sensors are there, those currents, low level, low amplitude, low frequency currents, can be easily sensed and with the proper impedance matching, so that there is no possibility of missing out on any result or any sensed reading. So even the transimpedance amplifiers also are of the similar category. Only thing here, the impedance is capacitive. The basic idea here is, because the regular amplifiers, if we make use of the coupling capacitors, the shunting effect, or at low frequencies because of the high impedance, the voltage gains may be very, very low because of the coupling capacitor. So to minimize that, here if the input impedance is made capacitive, then these currents, they are made to charge these capacitors. So the charge is developed across the capacitor proportional to the sensed current. They develop the voltage. So this voltage, which is developed proportional to the current which is sensed by the sensor, is made available for amplification. This signal gets amplified and you get very easily the high gain voltages. Similarly, even in charge amplifiers, the net impedance is capacitive. So the input and output impedances are made capacitive with the help of connecting a suitable value capacitor in the feedback path, also at the input terminals. So at the input terminals which we connect, that charges to the voltage proportional to the sensed current, and this capacitor which converts it or integrates the voltages, the currents into voltages. So for this purpose, either the charge amplifiers, basically the current to voltage converters, or the transimpedance amplifiers, where the impedance itself is made capacitive, they help in sensing the current and converting it to voltage. So along with this, they balance the input and output impedances also. So here, when you design electrometer circuits, certain parameters are of crucial importance, especially the guards or the shielding what you use, their potentials. If they are not maintained at proper potential, their capacitance may have some impact on the input impedance, plus the voltage what they develop between the common grounds or the casing. That is also very, very important, because that also may be developed as a voltage at the input terminals, and instead of the sensor reading, this may be taken as the sensed output. So always there is a possibility of erroneous result being amplifier. So for this, proper protection for the network has to be taken, because there is every possibility of drift happening due to ambient or the case temperature variations, or maybe the internal temperature of the circuit, because the semiconducting devices naturally change, or the for every 10 degree rise the currents are doubling. Because of this, continuously there is a power dissipation happening in the circuit. So all these things may lead to drifts or drift voltages which may be getting developed here. So the electrometer circuits, when you design, this care has to be taken, especially the maintenance of the temperatures of the shielding or guard or the reference voltages, any spurious or the random voltages getting developed. So this care has to be taken, proper grounding arrangement, and also placing the different components. Two high dissipative resistors cannot be placed adjacent to one another, because the energy dissipated, which in turn gets converted to heat, and this heat may affect the neighboring component, and that also may start getting heated up. So the concerns for heat or the power dissipation has to be taken. So the layout of the circuit should be proper. And if there is any issue, then that should be properly guarded or shielded with respect to certain reference voltage. These reference voltages take care of the spurious voltages which are being developed by these temperature variations or the drifts happening with the resistors or the op amps. Now also, when you design the electrometer circuits, instead of using the relays, proper soldering has to be done. If you start using the relays, the connection between the relay and the resistor or any other power dissipating component may give rise to additional power dissipation or change in the resistors. So one has to properly solder the circuit, and the lead resistors also have to be properly adjusted. High lead resistances should not be used. And also, all the resistors which are used should have proper power dissipation. So the next one is charge amplifier, where two capacitors are used in the feedback path as well as in the input path, such that the impedances are capacitive. Both input and output impedances are capacitive in nature. Also, the current which is sensed is made to flow through the input capacitor. As a result, the charges which are developed proportional to the sensed current are developing the voltage here. This voltage gets converted to, or rather this voltage is amplified. So basically here the current to voltage conversion is happening through the capacitor charging. So these ICs are actually available. So here proper these feedback path resistance and capacitors have to be designed. Also, there are two mechanisms. One, you can connect directly the capacitor, the input capacitance, in series with the sensor, or you can use a series resistance to balance the impedances. So here the combination of R1 and CS gives you the, along with RS of course, where the source resistance, that is the resistance of the sensor, plus the input resistance and the capacitance here of the charge amplifier. They are forming the input path, and the output path you have R0 and C0, which provide the feedback path as well as help in current to voltage conversion. So all these which we have designed are operating well in the low frequency regions. So later we concentrated on the noise, different noises in the amplifiers or the overall setup, and what are the sources of noise and how exactly these noises can be reduced. So basically we studied the short noise and thermal noise. Thermal noise is also called as Johnson's noise or Nyquist noise. Short noise is also called as Schottky noise. And the bandwidth of these noises depends upon the signal which is getting produced. And the total noise signal produced depends upon the bandwidth of these noise signals or the random signals which are getting produced at the input. All of them are dependent on the temperature. Now, how to reduce them? So, by properly adjusting the gains, these spurious noise signals can be adjusted. So, other sources of noise in op-amps are basically the offset currents and the offset voltage sources. So, these are the reductions and how exactly they vary with the frequency. This we have discussed even in the op-amp circuits also. So all the noise sources are basically the resistive noises, the offset current and offset voltage sources, plus the drift happening or the drift associated with any of these components. And we have the capacitors also forming between two conducting elements. So these two conducting elements, they can be two conductors, they can be two resistors, they can be two connecting leads. So these are also generating the voltages. So they have to be reduced with the help of proper casing and shielding. So in each one of them, the sources are same. Only thing, in instrumentation amplifiers, we have, because two different amplifier stages are there, the two different input impedances are to be considered here. Because it is in the different amplifier mode, so none of these are grounded. As a result, each one whose bias currents or the offset currents are going to have an impact on the noise produced in the instrumentation amplifier. So here two noise sources we have considered, and by considering the two noise sources the equation comes to this, and by adjusting these two to be equal we can minimize the total noise produced in the instrumentation amplifiers. So drifts basically happen because of the difference in the operating temperature and the ambient temperature. So the circuit temperatures are different, casing temperatures are different. Because of these two differences, there is a power getting dissipated. And that depends upon the thermal resistance of these resistors which are used, whether it is a fixed resistor or a potentiometer type or a variable resistor. Irrespective of that, one has to consider here the to minimize the drifts, the temperatures have to be properly maintained. First thing, the internal temperatures which are generated in the devices, they have to be cooled down with the help of either air conditioners or fan or heat sinks. So by doing this, this power dissipated can be controlled. So even in fixed resistors or in potentiometers or preset or trimming resistors, the noise produced is controlled with the help of proper maintaining the voltage reference voltages, and the excess power developed can be minimized by heat sinks. So this is what we studied in the previous chapter. So considering these things, in the next class we are going to solve the numericals. The numericals, you need to understand properly how the solution you have to arrive at. There is no standard method as such. You have to understand the concepts properly, only then you will be able to solve them.